which makes sure that Mawlaka, our Lord, does not see us. Our Lord does not look at us whilst we in a position, whilst we in a situation, whilst we're doing an action that He has prohibited. This is clear. When one has this quality in him, that my Allah, my Lord should not see me in a state that He has prohibited me from, when this quality comes in a person, we will say that he is not haya. So, haya, if you look at it, it's a natural feeling, a natural pain that man has in himself when the idea of committing something wrong comes in. In English, we might call it our conscience. Now, any man, however evil he is, he has a conscience that would stop him from that evil at some part of his life. If he pays heed to that conscience, if he listens to his conscience at that time and changes his life, then he'll be successful. But if he does not pay heed, he ignores his conscience and carries on doing what he has been doing all his life, then he has failed. So respected elders and dear brothers in Islam, mothers and sisters in Islam, we understand that this word haya in Arabic, or this word haya in the context of Islam, is our conscience or an inner feeling which prevents us from all kinds of evil. An inner feeling that would say no when an intention is created in our hearts to do something evil. After having understood the definition of haya, let us look at the ayat of Quran and the ahadith of Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam which speak in regards to haya. Islam draws the contrast between haya and immorality. Haya, which we may translate as morality, and immorality, Islam draws the contrast between the two. Wherein Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Holy Quran, أَشْشَيْطَانُ يَعِدُكُمُ الْفَقْرَ وَيَأْمُرُكُمْ بِالْفَحْشَى. That shaytan promises you poverty. And shaytan commands you to do those actions that are evil. Look at this beautiful ayat of the Holy Quran. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَشْشَيْطَانُ يَعِدُكُمُ الْفَقْرَ. That shaytan promises you poverty. And when man fears poverty, he is ready to do whatever he can do. We see that in life, it's at the verge of poverty that man is ready to do any immoral act in life. Whether it be exploitation of someone else's wealth, or whether it be doing any shameful act in order to gain the money that he does not have, man is ready to do anything in poverty. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, shaytan promises poverty. And in promising poverty, what does shaytan succeed in doing? Shaytan, by promising poverty, keeping poverty in front, shaytan succeeds in commanding us or in ordering us to do acts which are immoral and shameful. On the other hand, إِنَّمَا حَرَّمَ رَبِّيَ الْفَوَاحِشِ. Allah has prohibited all kinds of indecent and vulgar activity. So on one hand, Islam draws the contrast. On one hand, there's shaytan here promising us poverty and commanding us to do those things that are evil. And on the other hand, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbids us to stay away from all such acts that are immoral and shameful. Similarly, in the ahadith of Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, مَا كَانَ الْحَيَاءُ فِي شَيْءٍ إِلَّا ذَانَهُ مَا كَانَ الْفُحْشُ فِي شَيْءٍ إِلَّا شَانَهُ. That whenever there is modesty, there is haya, there is morality in an action. مَا كَانَ الْحَيَاءُ فِي شَيْءٍ. Whichever action has haya in it, إِلَّا ذَانَهُ, it beautifies and adorns that action. Whatever action man does, whether it be an ibadah or his conducting any act of life, any action of life. Any action in life, ما كان الحياء في شيء. If there's حياء in that action, then that action is wrong. That action will look beautiful. وما كان الفحش في شيء إلا شانه. That when immorality, shamefulness, the shamelessness comes into an action, إلا شانه, it disfigures it. It makes that action look very ugly. The difference between an action which is beautiful and an action which is disfigured is haya. If there's haya, the action is beautiful. If there's no haya, the action is disfigured. Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Al-haya'u min al-iman, al-imanu fil jannah. Wal-bada'u min al-jafa' wal-jafa'u min al-na'u. That haya is part of iman. And iman will lead the person to jannah, lead him into paradise. So the end result of haya is the person will attain paradise. Wal-bada'u min al-jafa' and immorality, immodesty is from vulgarity. And وَالْجَفَاءُ مِنَ النَّاسِ Vulgarity will only lead us to the haya. So if a person has this quality of haya in him, the end result is nothing but jannah. And on the other hand, if a person does not have this quality of haya, and he conducts immoral acts and shameless acts, then this person ends up in the fire of jannah. And the centerpiece of all activity in Islam is haya. That's why Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a hadith explaining that the branches of iman, Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Al-haya'u shu'batun min al-iman. The haya is part of iman. Haya is centerpiece of all activity of iman. Without haya, no action of iman is good. And with haya, every action of iman is beautified. Like in a hadith. This is understood very beautifully from the incident of Shu'bah bin Hajjaj. Shu'bah bin Hajjaj, those that studied the field of hadith would know that Shu'bah bin Hajjaj is known as Amirul Mu'mineen fil Hadith. That once while Shu'bah was traveling or he was on his conveyance, Abdullah bin Maslama, who later became known as Abdullah bin Maslama al-Qa'nabi, he was the street urchin, or in our terms, the gangster of their time. So he holds on to the conveyance of Shu'bah bin Hajjaj and he tells him, tell me a hadith, teach me a hadith. So the Shu'bah bin Hajjaj, he explains to him that this is not the place for me to teach you a hadith. The occasion and the environment is not suitable for me to teach you hadith. You come to my place, you come to the mosque, I'll teach you hadith there. So being the gangster that he was, he holds on to the reins even tighter. He holds on to the conveyance even tighter and he says, teach me a hadith otherwise. Teach me a hadith or else. And that time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enlightened Shu'bah bin Hajjaj with a hadith which was most appropriate for that occasion. Shu'bah bin Hajjaj says, إِذَا فَاتَكَ الْحَيَاءُ فَفْعَلْ مَا شِئْتَ. The narration becomes, إِذَا لَمْ يَسْتَحِي فَفْعَلْ مَا شِئْتَ. If you do not have haya, then you do whatever you want. Saying that this act of yours that you're doing, it's because you don't have haya. So when a person does not have haya, he can engage in any immoral activity that he wants to. So much so that as a Muslim community, or as Muslims, their haya should have been our greatest moral trait. Today we see that we have stooped so low, that there was an incident, whether it was in a Muslim community or not, I'm not sure. But still, this incident does not even allow us to consider ourselves as humans. An incident where in a hospital a baby was brought 3 to 4 months old. I'm not talking about any other country, I'm talking about our hospital in Dahiwala, the Kalubowila hospital. A baby was brought and the baby was refusing to suckle the milk of the mother. So when brought, and the baby became very weak because of that, when brought to the hospital, the doctor revealed, it's very shameful to say something like this in the mosque, but this is for us to understand to what level the humanity at large has stooped so low, to what levels they have stooped, that the father has engaged this baby in oral sex, due to which certain type of fungal activity of fungus has been created in the mouth of the baby, and where the baby is unable to take in the milk of the mother. إذا فاتك الحياة فافعل ما شئت. That when man loses haya, when man loses his modesty, he is ready to go through whatever he wants. He is ready to do whatever he wants. He is ready to stoop to such low standards. When this haya is in where her son has been martyred in the battlefield. Sahabiya in her parda, she comes to the battlefield and the other Sahaba are shocked at how she takes the news and at her action, that she does not cry and she does not make a big scene at the battlefield. So the Sahaba, they question in class, do you not feel the depressed, or do you not feel the sadness of the passing away of your son? So she replies so beautifully that indeed I have lost my son, but I haven't lost my haya, and I have lost my morality. These are the Sahaba of Allah, and they possess this quality of haya, which should be the moral trait of Muslims today. And today, if you look at the lifestyle of Muslims, we see that this ingredient is missing in the non-Muslims. So after having understood what haya is and the importance of haya, let us understand that there's a great link between haya and between one of the greatest urges that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created in man, that is the sexual appetite. It's in the innate character of man that he has to fulfill his desires. Allah has created this hunger in him, or this appetite in him. But when you look at history, man has responded to this hunger or to this appetite in three different ways. There is one group of humans who have said that let us suppress our desire. Let us suppress. Allah has created this desire. We have this desire let us suppress our desire. This is against the natural order. And this is against the command of Allah, wherein Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants the progeny of man to continue. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذْ قُلْنَا لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ اسْجُدُوا وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. That we have made man the vicegerent, our khalifas in this world. And it's the command of Allah that humankind should continue. So suppressing our desire is against this command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's against the natural order. Like we see water that is flowing, if it stops, when it becomes stagnant, then we see it becomes a host to many diseases. Stagnant water becomes a host to many diseases. In the same way, when one suppresses his desire, then we see that he becomes a victim to many spiritual and physical diseases, many spiritual and physical complications, wherein he cannot handle himself physically and spiritually. And we know that certain group of people who take an oath of celibacy, they look into their lifestyle, or if you look into the inside information that comes out, each and every one of us sitting here are aware of what happens to those people who take an oath of celibacy, but we know that we cannot handle it, they cannot handle it. The suppression of desires is not a good option. The second option that man, or the second way in which man has responded to this desire, this might sound very attractive to those not married or even some of the youngsters sitting here. That is, we be allowed to fulfill our desires in whatever way and with whoever we want to. So, a group of men or group of humans have responded in this way that Allah has, okay, God has created this urge in me. So I have responded in this way that I'll fulfill my desires with whosoever I want to, whenever and however I want to. This might sound attractive, but let us look at the repercussions. What will happen in a society where everyone thinks that he can sleep with whomsoever he wants to? We see that in such a society, human beings reduce themselves to the status or to the level of animals. They are animals, they do not have family life. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala differentiates animals from human beings, one of the differentiating factors that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explains is the man has a spouse and he creates a family through that spouse. He's joined to a separate family, his in-laws through that spouse. And animals do not have that. What difference would we have from the animals if such a society is created? Secondly, even if man is able to fulfill his physical desires through this, emotionally he would have a vacuum. He would have an emotional vacuum which would not be filled by going from bed to bed. You see people who go from bed to bed, that emotionally they feel very depressed and they're stressed. And they have to take medication in order to control their depression. So it leaves an emotional vacuum. And thirdly, it is distortion of human values. And fourthly, it will create a very cruel society where human beings will be respected only for their, or appreciated only for their good looks. So the moment or when a time comes when human beings become old, they would hold no respect because there is no family. They have been fulfilling their desires with whomsoever they wanted. So they hold no family, they hold no people who would respect them. And once they have lost their youth, they have lost everything. So as attractive as the second response of man might sound, the repercussions of it brings man to the level of animal and creates a society which is very vulnerable and creates a society which is very poor. The third option is the one which is encouraged in Quran, and that is the only correct option. That is, man fulfills his desires within the confines of nikah. The fulfillment of desires outside nikah is haram. And fulfillment of desires within the confines of nikah is halal. So much so that Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when explaining it to the Sahaba, says, "Fi bud'i ahadikum sadaqah," that in fulfilling your desires with your spouses, it's sadaqah, it's rewarding, you get the reward of sadaqah. So Sahaba, perplexed, confused, they ask Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, "We fulfill our desires with our spouses and we are rewarded for that?" Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explains that if you had fulfilled them in the wrong place, wouldn't you be sinful for that? Sahaba replied in the affirmative. Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, in the same manner, when it's fulfilled in a halal way, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rewards it. This is Islamic perspective, and this is what Islam teaches us, and this is what Islam encourages. That desire that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created in us should be fulfilled within the confines of nikah, and outside nikah, fulfillment of such desires becomes haram. And Islam not only prohibits this, but Islam goes a step further and prohibits all those actions that lead to fornication, and that lead to adultery, that lead to zina. And this has been the sunnah, or this has been the practice of Islam. That Islam not only prohibits a certain action, Islam prohibits everything that leads to that action. For example, for us to understand, let us take shift. Describing partners to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Islam prohibits shirk and says that there cannot be anything worse, any action which is worse than shirk, anything that is worse than shirk. But at the same time, Islam prohibits photography, Islam prohibits pictures, Islam prohibits the making of sculptures. Why? Because people of the past, they made sculptures, they made idols out of their elders, out of the pious from amongst them. They made pictures of the pious people from amongst them. And later on, Shaitan drove them into worshipping the same pictures and idols. Islam prohibits worshipping of idols, ascribing partners to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and also prohibits making of pictures and sculptures. Why? That leads to ascribing partners to Allah. Similarly, Islam does not only prohibit us from zina, Islam prohibits us from all those actions that lead to zina. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Holy Quran does not say that do not involve yourselves in fornication, but rather Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا تَقْرَبُ الزِّنَا. Do not even come close to zina. Do not even come close to fornication in the adultery. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shuts down all those parts that lead to adultery. One of them being that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us to lower our gazes. قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغُضُّوا مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ وَيَحْفَظُوا فُرُوجَهُمْ. Oh, the Nabi of Allah, tell to the believing males, يَغُضُّوا مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ, they should lower their gazes. They should lower their gazes. Why? By casting one's gaze at something which is haram, something which is impermissible, it would lead to zina. Casting a glance is the first step towards zina. And so Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in hadith says, Al-aynani tazniyan. The eyes also involve themselves in fornication. What's the fornication of eyes? Looking at something which is prohibited. That's the adultery and fornication of eyes. Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, An-nadru sahmun min siham iblis. That's another, casting our gazes is an arrow from the arrows of Iblis. Why? This is the first step towards immorality. This is the first step towards fornication. Islam commands us to lower our gazes. And not cast a lustful glance, even a normal glance. To cast upon something which is haram to something which is haram. And this ruling is not only for men but also for women. Many of the rulings we see in the Quran are set on a general basis, where the masculine gender is used and the same ruling applies for feminine also. But here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala emphasizes and says, قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغُضُّوا مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ. And in the very next ayah, وَقُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنَاتِ يَغْضُنَّ مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِنَّ. That, O Nabi of Allah, tell the women also that they should lower their gazes. Once, whilst Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was with his azwaj mutahharat, with his wives, a Sahabi enters the house of Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abdullah ibn Umm Maktoum, who we know was a Sahabi who could not see, he was a blind Sahabi. So when he entered the house, Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ordered his wives to go in. So upon this, Umm Salama and Maymuna radiallahu anhuma, who were the wives present there, saying that, O Nabi of Allah, this Sahabi is blind, he cannot see. So why should we go in? Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked the Sahabi, are you also blind? Saying them as it is incorrect and haram for a person to lay his gazes upon a woman who is not his mahram. In the same manner, it is haram for a woman to lay her gazes upon a man who is not his mahram. Today we tend not to understand this. Because women are in farda, we understand that it's incorrect for us to look at women. But because the men are not in farda, women do not take it as wrong for them to look at men. Men are not in farda because men are the ones who are commanded to be in the outside world. And when it comes in regard to women, men are supposed to fulfill all the needs of the women which are outside the house. And women have no such responsibility. All responsibility of women are within the house. Yes, for some reason, for some necessity, the woman wants to be out of the house, then yes, she can go out of the house, but with her. Now many occasions raised when we look at this ayah, قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغْضُضْنَ مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِنَّ وَيَحْفَظْنَ فُرُوجَهُنَّ وَلَا يُبْدِينَ زِينَتَهُنَّ إِلَّا مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا. That the women should not make their adornment become apparent. إِلَّا مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا, except for that which is apparent. Now in the tafsir of this hadith, we see that Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, in tafsir of إِلَّا مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا, he says that it refers to the outer clothing of the woman, that is the burqa or the veil. The veil, a woman is only allowed to show her burqa and the veil and nothing else. But when we look at the tafsir of Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, we see that he says that women are allowed to show their faces and hands. So many, I won't use the word Ali, many a person who wants to research Quran on his own, tends to say that this verse of the Quran allows women to show their faces and hands. So why are the ulama making it compulsory upon the women to cover their faces? The answer to this, respected elders and brothers, mothers and sisters in Islam, let us listen carefully, is that this ruling is in a time when there is no fitna. For example, the woman has to be in front of a qadi, of a judge, and judge has to pass a verdict. Judge has to see the face of the woman to pass a verdict, making sure it's the same person. So in such cases of necessity and in cases where there is no fitna, this is the ruling. Otherwise, I'll leave you with one hadith, and I'll let you decide whether it's compulsory to cover the face or not. Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, لَعْنَ اللَّهُ النَّاظِرَ وَالْمَنْظُورَ. That Allah has cursed that person who casts his glance or casts his gaze upon something which is haram, and also that person who allows herself to be looked at. A person who looks at haram is also cursed by Allah. I'm not saying this is the hadith of Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And a person, especially, Muhaddithin explained this especially in regard to women who allow themselves to be looked at, also come under this curse. What more evidence do we need to prove that it is incumbent upon women to cover that curse? Are we looking for anything new? Moreover, in regards to the Azwaj Mutahhara, they are known as Mutahhara, the chaste ones, the wives of Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the chaste ones. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals an ayah, وَإِذَا سَأَلْتُمُوهُنَّ فَاسْأَلُوهُنَّ مِنْ وَرَاءِ حِجَابٍ ذَلِكُمْ أَطْهَرُ لِقُلُوبِكُمْ وَقُلُوبِهِمْ. That when you question them, when you speak to them behind the veil. Allah commands the Sahaba radiallahu anhum that when they speak to the wives, who are the ummahatul mu'mineen, the mothers of this ummah, when they speak to them, they should speak to them behind the veil. Why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, it is better for the purity of your heart and the purity of their heart. Any questions? Is there any doubt in the purity and in the being chaste of the azwaj of Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala command them to be in farda? If such chaste women like the azwaj are supposed to be in farda, then can there be any question or any doubt remaining in regards to the women of today? That it is incumbent upon them. It is better for the purification of their heart that they be in farda. It's better for the purification of the heart that of those who look at them, that these women are in farda. I rest my case there and I say I leave it up to you all to decide after having given you all the hadith of Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the ayat of the Quran that makes it incumbent upon the azwaj to be in farda, whether it's incumbent upon the women of today that they be in farda or not. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prohibits us from glancing or looking at that which is haram. Why? Because this leads to death. Today, leave out casting a lustful gaze. People have gone a step further. And they see that people are involved, even Muslims, involved in looking at nudity and pornography that is available so easily today. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prohibits us from casting a glance, then what could be the ruling in regard to those people who are involved in such immorality? And then look at the hijab, just to finish off with the topic of hijab. You see that this hijab in reality frees a woman from being perceived as a sexual object. If you see the look at the Western society, then a woman's worth is proportionate to her attractiveness. And a woman has become an advertisement tool, an advertising tool, wherein even something as masculine as a car or a tractor, a woman is used to advertise that. They would not rest until they strip that woman off and expose her nudity just in order to market their product. This is the Western society. In the Western society, a woman's worth is proportionate to her attractiveness. So once she loses her attractiveness, once she loses her youth, she's worthless. That's why the greatest fear in the Western society is getting old. That's why you find that one of the fastest selling products in the market is anti-aging creams and anti-aging lotions, etc. Medications which they say will stop you from aging, but once you reach that age, you reach that age. But on the other hand, when you look at Islam, that the older the woman grows, the more she gains respect. And it's in the guise of the mother, of a mother, that Islam has given the greatest accolade that could be given to a human being. Wherein Islam says that Jannah, paradise, lies under the feet of the mother. This is the status that Islam gives to women. Islam has actually freed women from being perceived as a sexual object. But we don't seem to understand this, and we think that Islam actually makes it difficult upon women and makes it incumbent upon them to be that. So the first step is that we avoid, or we do not look at those things that we should not be looking. The second thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prohibited us from, those things that lead to zina, is touching a woman or touching a man that is non-mahram to us, that we are not supposed to touch. That Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions that it is better for a person to be hit through his head with an iron rod than touching a woman who he is not supposed to touch. Today, many ideologies say that, oh, it's fine as long as you don't involve in adultery. I mean, it's against respect that we don't shake hands with women. And some spiritual leaders too, they claim themselves to be very pure, and they say it's all right for us to interact with women and for women to take bayas at our hands. But the most purest of all human beings, the greatest of all human beings, Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when women took bayat at the hands of Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they did not touch Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam behind the veil gave his staff a turban, wherein the women held on to the turban from one side, and Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam held on to the turban from the other side, and the women took bayat at the hands of Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the question I pose is, can someone claim to have more piety than Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? If he can claim to do so, then we do allow him to touch women and for women to take bayat at his hands. But if he doesn't claim to do so, then we say that it's prohibited for him to touch women. The third thing that Islam prohibits for us not to, which is a means of getting close to zina, is being in seclusion with the opposite sex. Islam prohibits us from being in seclusion with the opposite sex. Whether it be in a room, whether it be our secretary who is sharing the same room, or whether it be in a vehicle where the driver is driving and a woman is in seclusion, she is in solitude with a male who is her non-mahram. Islam prohibits us from this. I, Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, say that no two people, that is a man and a woman, are together where the third person is shaitan. So when a male and a female are in solitude, the third person is definitely shaitan. And this male and female can claim to be as pious as they want to be. That male can be as pious as Hasan Basri, and that female can be as pious as Rabia Basriya, but still too, shaitan will make utmost effort to make sure that these two involve in act of immorality. Shaitan will not stop until he succeeds in doing so. Islam stops us from such actions that lead to zina, that lead to fornication, that lead to adultery. So my dear respected elders and brothers, after having understood that, and after having understood the harms of immorality, let us now look at the solution. How do we create modesty? How do we create morality within our community? So the first step that we should be taking is keeping away from these things that Islam says that leads to zina. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا الزِّنَا. So we keep away from all those actions, whether it be casting a glance at a non-mahram. Now, Islam allows us to cast the first glance, but that is the first glance which is unintentional. Now the youth take advantage of it, they say the first glance is permissible. So in that first glance they have a proper look, and they say, no, it's permitted in Islam. So this first glance that Islam is talking about is that glance which is unintentional. So, let us keep away from casting glances or looking at that which is haram. Let us keep away from touching those people whom we are not supposed to touch. Let us keep away from being in seclusion with such people that we are not supposed to be in seclusion. This is the first step that we take. And let us also understand that the greater the resistance towards temptation, the greater the reward. That is, when we look at casting the glance, Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, or Abu Umama radiallahu anhu narrates, مَا مِن مُسْلِمٍ يَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ إِمْرَاةٍ أَوَّلَ رَمَقَةٍ ثُمَّ يَغُضُّ بَصَرَهُ إِلَّا أَحْدَثَ اللَّهُ لَهُ عِبَادَةً يَجِدُ حَلَاوَتَهَا. That any person who casts a glance, now we're talking about this unintentional glance, who casts an unintentional glance and thereafter lowers his gaze, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant him the sweetness of such an ibadah that the sweetness will remain with that person for a very long time. Dear youth, when we see an attractive woman or an attractive girl in front of us, the moment we look at her and we lower our glances, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that Allah that action of us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant such sweetness in that action. That sweetness will remain with us for a very long time. We will enjoy that action for a very long time. Let us try this one. And we'll see that how enjoyable that action is. Nora Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, كُلُّ عَيْنٍ بَاكِيَةٌ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ, that every eye will be crying on the day of Qiyamah except three. Besides three eyes, every eye will be crying on the day of Qiyamah. And from those three eyes, one is that person who lowered his gaze when he could look at something which is haram. Number two, that person who stayed awake in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And number three, a person from whose eyes a tear drops in the fear of Allah. So from among the three eyes, the eye of a person who lowered his gaze when he had the capability and the opportunity to look at something which was haram. And let us understand that there's no end point to this desire. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in regards to zina, وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا الزِّنَا إِنَّهُ كَانَ فَاحِشَةً وَسَاءَ سَبِيلًا, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says this is an evil path. And being an evil path, the more we give in to our desires, the demands will increase. It's a folly to believe that, you know, I'll do it once and then I'll stop. It doesn't stop. It increases. Do you think that whilst we're young, we'll fulfill our desires and then after we grow old, we'll stop? No. The desires will only increase as we grow. The more we indulge ourselves in this act, the more the desires are going to grow. It's like a person involved in drugs or alcohol. A person involved in drugs, he thinks, okay, this is the last, I mean, I'll have a good time, I'll be high, and after that I'll stop. At the moment the effects of the drugs go away, he wants more. Similarly, giving into our desires is not an option. We tend to think that let us give into our desires, giving to the desires, and thereafter, you know, when I fulfill my desires 100%, then I'll stop. It's never going to happen. It's just a myth. It's a folly. Let us not give. So the first step that we have to take is keep away from those aspects that lead us to this. The second step that we should be taking, and this has become a very common problem, that we should not soften perception in regards to immorality. That is, we should not take morality very lightly. Today, we should not take immorality very lightly. Today, immoral acts has become very light and it has, become part of our jokes. So much so on social media, we see jokes that are very immoral, but we just have a laugh and we let it go. Just the other day someone showed me that never force your children to pray before they eat. Muslims also give dua before they eat. Christians also have a prayer before they eat. So don't force your children to pray before they eat. Why is it one child was forced to pray before he ate? So he prays that, oh God, provide clothing for all those naked women on my dad's iPhone. And provide houses for all those men who visit our house when my dad is not here. Now, this may seem a joke, but this is softening perception. He's taking immorality very lightly. This is the height of immorality. They are the mother and father. Set such an example to the children. The height of morality, but we take it as a joke. So let us not talk in perception. In our jokes, in our talk, let us not talk in perception. And secondly, movies. movies actually glorify immorality. Everyone would agree to me that 99% of the movies, the message that is put across is those people involved in an immoral relationship, in a haram relationship, are the hero and the heroine of the movie. And those people who oppose it, they've got loose morals. Is this the message we're sending across to our children? The other day someone was speaking to me, they're from our community. There's a whole family from grandfather till grandchild, going to the cinema and watching such movies. Tomorrow, when our children come to us and say, "Mommy, this is my girlfriend," what are you going to tell them? This is what we have taught them. If television is in the house for other reasons, like watching the news, etc., there are other means through which you can get news today. Before, there was a time where we could say only radio would give us news and television would give us news. Today, there's so many dot-coms that would give us news. So it's not necessary that shaitan box be there in our house. And if it's there and we're watching such dramas and such movies in front of our children, then this is what we said, creating immorality or softening perceptions for our children. What examples are they going to take? They tend to think that I am a hero if I am immoral. Who are we to blame? So we should soften perceptions when it comes to immorality. And number three, we should avoid all such customs that are immoral. Now, many of you sitting here or those not sitting here already must have prepared for the 14th of this month that is coming. That custom is not only immoral, but it's also something which is based on a pagan religion. And Islam tells us, وَلَا تَرْكَنُوا إِلَى الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا فَتَمَسَّكُمُ النَّارُ, that we should not be inclined towards the actions of the transgressors and the disbelievers, lest the fire of Jahannam should catch us. So being immoral, being an act of immorality, is also an act in which we get the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and we drive ourselves towards the fire of Jahannam. They let us not involve ourselves. Today we look at schools. Certain schools, they make it compulsory that the students of the schools are involved in immoral acts, whether they be dances or music parties or what. Sending our children to such schools, showing them or teaching them to become immoral. Tomorrow, who are we today? Today, magazines of leading international schools, if you look at them, they have a few pages at the end, which, say the most talented student in the school, or the foodie of the school, the one who eats most in the school. In that column, they also got the flirt of the school. This immorality has become so common that the students are bold enough to put it in front of the teachers and the parents that this person is a flirt in studying school. They got Mr. and Mrs. so and so from the school. On the school magazine, there was a time this was happening, but they would make sure that the news doesn't go to the parents or the teachers. Today, it's become common. They soften perception. They allow immorality to creep into our lives, through media, through our jokes, through our speech. We should be sure that these things are true. Number five, we should make morality attractive. We should make modesty attractive. We make decency attractive. Today, it's the opposite. Indecency becomes attractive. Wearing clothes where our underpants are seen becomes attractive. I don't know for what reason. one understands, one should feel shameful of itself that another person is able to look at something which should be concealed. But on the other hand, it's becoming attractive. Decency should become attractive. Today, a person who has had many girlfriends is looked up as a hero. And then a person who's punctual to scholar, he should be looked at as a hero. A person who's decent and dresses decently, he should be looked at as a hero. There is no decency. From amongst the solutions, number 5 would be that when our children come of age, let us give them marriage. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, يَا مَأْشَرَ الشَّبَابِ مَنِ اسْتَطَاعَ مِنْكُمُ الْبَاعَةَ فَلْيَتَزَوَّجْ. If you've got the ability to get married, you should get married. Why? Because it's أَغَضَّ الْبَصَرِ and أَحْسَنَ الْفَرَجِ. It's a means of lowering our gazes and safeguarding our private parts. The means of safeguarding our immorality is that when it's time to get married, we should get married. And last but not least, we should fear Allah in this aspect. And we should ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to create morality amongst us. We should ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save us all from immodesty and immorality. I end with the words of Yusuf alayhi salam, wherein Yusuf alayhi salam, when he was invited to a dinner, where Zulaikha invited Yusuf alayhi salam to his dinner, he said, رَبِّ السِّجْنُ أَحَبُّ إِلَيْهِ مِمَّا يَدْعُونَنِي إِلَيْهِ. That, O Allah, the prison is more beloved to me than what she is inviting me towards. That I'd rather be in prison than be immoral. And when she invited Yusuf alayhi salam, used the word, مَعَاذَ اللَّهِ إِنَّهُ رَبِّي أَحْسَنُ مَثْوَايَ. That, O Allah, save me. What Yusuf alayhi salam directed us towards is the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in such situations. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inculcate taqwa in us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inculcate that fear in us, that when we put in such a situation, the situation of immorality, we are able to get ourselves away from that, and we are able to create an environment of decency, an environment of morality, an environment where a decent person is respected, an environment where a decent person is looked up to, an environment where we please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, an environment that they are doing the times of Sahaba radiallahu anhum, their morality was a common trait among the Muslims. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make morality a common trait among us. وآخر دعوانا